Welcome to the stage, Richard Linklater. Anyway, all right, welcome to Rumblefish. Welcome back to the 80s. Let's go back 30 years, whatever. You know, a lot of this series, all I can provide is a little context, you know, about what this was like going to see this film at the time. And it's so exciting to watch a 35 print of this. I think I only saw it then, and I've seen it a couple times over the years, on maybe once on cable and once on VHS or DVD along the way, but this is such a treat. But, you know, going into, did any filmmaker ever have a better decade? Let's think of Coppola, and it's Coppola, it's not Coppola, like I said, for 30-something. Someone finally corrected me. It's Scorsese, not Scorsese. Redneck meets Italian, it's always a train wreck. But let's go through the 70s. Godfather, Conversation, Godfather Part II, Apocalypse Now. He didn't bat 1,000 in the 70s, he batted 2,000. The film god statistician said, you did so good, we're going to give you double credit for all those films. They were that good, people went back and paid again after they saw them. I mean, no one had a better decade, really, than that. Did they? I mean, is it possible to be that? Because they weren't just good films. A lot of people had great 70s, but they were huge hits. They were winning Oscars. No one could have been. I'm only saying all this to set the table for the 80s, what this series is about. And, you know, he was here. Francis was here a few years ago. And he was very honest. He spoke. I don't know. How many of you were at the over there when he spoke? Yeah. He's really very honest about his 80s. What he made this comment, like, he was so. Apocalypse Now had been such a troubled shoot. He had mortgaged his house, bet the farm, spent everything. It was going to be this huge disaster, so he kind of panicked and did, he thought, okay, I'll do a love story and make back the money that I'm teetering on bankruptcy. So he does One from the Heart. Well, it turns out Apocalypse Now is this huge hit, and One from the Heart is the film that bankrupts him. You know? And One from the Heart's wonderful movie. But I think it had barely came out. And I think he did that, if you go through film history, when the great artists seek a little too much autonomy. And, you know, he's bigger than life. Francis Coppola is, there's no one larger. And, you know, he had no problem saying fuck you to Hollywood, putting his own ass on the line his whole career. And I think he had gotten, you know, his own company up in the Bay Area. And he had extended himself a little, probably too far in the independent direction, like Buster Keaton, Preston Sturges. You know, you can just run through the filmmakers who went out there at the moment they declare their ultimate freedom. Well, here comes the forces of the universe to, you know, crush that. And everyone joins in. Everybody, you know, media, everybody loved his failure for some reason. I was, it's really sad in my mind because, you know, he's one of the greats. But, you know, he had this debt. He talked about it when he was here. He had this debt of like $20 million. You know, there's a famous moment. He and Scorsese were talking, and Scorsese is saying, like, yeah, and I'm broke. And he goes, yeah, you're broke. I owe $20 million. You know, that's how bad the 80s were at that point. But, you know, he did the honorable thing, and this is why, he's such an incredible guy. He could have declared bankruptcy and just got on with his next thing, but, you know, he's like, I'm going to pay off that debt. You know, it's going to take me a while. And so he said in the 80s, he had this payment every year he had to do. And so he started doing, you know, I think he just had to, it's a portrait, you know, the industry had changed and his circumstances were such that he's scrambling around for financeable projects that he can get made. So he gets into the S.E. Hinton world. He's doing The Outsiders. And so in part of that, he starts writing Rumblefish. I think he gets the rights or gets excited about Rumblefish. And the contrast between Outsiders and this, could it be more? I mean, it's amazing that these films were sister films. I mean, they were like on top of each other. He was writing one while he was doing, writing this while he was doing Outsiders. And they go right into it with the same crew, so many of the same cast. You know, just they're right on top of each other. But he kind of goes a whole different way. And this is what I think is so fascinating about his work, you know, at this time. Oh, by the way, you know, everybody fucking hated this movie and kind of hated what he was doing. And, you know, it didn't do well at the box office despite this incredible cast. I remember reading the reviews. You know, I was like, you know, reading up on it, and everyone's, oh, he just, you know, he's full of shit, he's doing all this crazy stuff, and what's he doing? But the real disappointment, I think, was like, you know, you can't do The Godfather. You can't do Apocalypse Now every time out. But, you know, in a way, he actually does. That's what I think people missed when they see the movie. He takes, I mean, what is The Godfather? It's, you know, these sleazeball guys killing each other over, you know, drug turf and all that, but he elevates it, not only at the writing stage, but, you know, in the movie, he makes myths. You know, like I said, no one thinks bigger and grander than Francis. So in his own way, you know, he does that with these teen movies, these two S.E. Hinton novels, in very different ways. You know, that was his traditional, the American movie everybody thought they grew up watching in, when was it, maybe the 50s or something. I don't know when that existed. But, you know, the kids go into the burning building. I didn't like Outsiders as much as I like this, because it's, Rumblefish to me was just radical, you know. Black and white, not too many films at that time were black and white. You know, it's his German expressionist film. It's his, like, I was only half kidding last week when I said it's his Bergman film, you know, in the intro. It really is, and he just goes way out there, and he elevates, you know, everything to that level. So it's an amazing, and I think there's an element of him, you know, he's doing it for the studios. Hell, he is Francis Ford Coppola. He's getting these films made, but he's really biting the hand. It's a very subversive film. It's surreal. It's dreamy. It's kind of crazy. So it's really to be admired, you know, but I see it now as, you know, he wasn't that old a guy. This is a guy in the 70s. He was in his 30s, you know, when he hit the absolute peak. And so here, like so many of his peers of his generation, they're struggling. They're just struggling to get their next film made and stay relevant and stay in the world that they love and have created. So I see his 80s film. And his 80s films are really wonderful. If you go back and look at them film by film, I mean, Cotton Club I thought was great, but they all had this similar response. Like, people were sort of gloating over his struggles, and you can't make The Godfather. You know, you can't. He was the prisoner of his own, like, success and masterpieces that he had produced. So it's a pretty horrible position to find yourself in. But all he did was make one really interesting film after the other throughout the 80s and into the 90s, and still today. I mean, the films he's doing right now, he took that, there was a kind of a hiatus there, but his last films, I find them really interesting. I mean, there's no one else quite like him. So, you know, Cotton Club was great. Tucker is great. You know, he just kept working. It's so admirable. And I mean, he's such an amazing talent, you know. So this is just a crazy film he did in Oklahoma with a great cast. And you can feel, it's almost like he's reinventing himself in a way as a filmmaker. He's excitable and he's trying stuff. He's experimenting. And he really goes into this story, you know. Rusty James. And so I said last week, you know, Matt Dillon, I want to dedicate tonight's screening to Matt fucking Dillon, the greatest teenage actor ever. Let's go through him. Over the Edge, which would be a part of this series if it had come out 1 year later.
Yeah, right.
79, Over the Edge, one of the great teenage movies ever made. And then there's My Bodyguard, great performance. Little Darlings, many women's favorite movie of that era. These two movies, Outsiders, Rumblefish, Tex. Hey, I'm getting there. Tex, Flamingo Kid, and Liar's Moon. I don't know about that. That's seven great teenage performances in a relatively short amount of time. And the difference is, you know, when James Dean did Rebel Without a Cause, he was 24. Matt Dillon was actually a teenager. His first movie, he was cutting class up in Westchester County. They found him, this punk kid, and he's brilliant in that movie. I mean, has there ever been a more naturally gifted teenage actor? And Matt's a great adult actor. I'll go so far to say he's never been bad in a movie. I think he is just dead on. Did anyone see Factotum? He did the best Charles Bukowski, Hank Chanowski. He's incredible. Matt, he's just one of these incredible talents. But we'll talk about this after. Is he the greatest teenage actor ever? I think so. Bring your arguments. We're here after. So enjoy this movie, and we'll be around after. All right.
Well, Coppola said that I read where he was making The Outsiders, and he was just like, oh, am I going to get through this movie? The reward at the end of this will be that I'll make Rumblefish.
Yeah, which they're kind of polar opposites in a way. Like two different filmmakers, two different...
What is that principle that happens? It happens so often that all of a sudden somebody's just like, everyone rejoices in their failure. that happen with Coppola?
It's cool. They do it in life. They do it in politics. They do it in the arts. I don't know, man. We're all...
Why isn't Coppola like regarded as like
yeah,
this
why
great
couldn't
hero?
We go with them artistically and say, hey, he's doing something different. How cool. He's a great film artist. It's like, you know, we're sick of you. You know, you've done well. Time for someone else to do well, you know, or whatever. What is that impulse to drag people down? It's kind of... It's perceptional, you know, more than actual, but I think there's some property in the universe. It's just called, it's physical, it's biological, just regression to the mean, you know, like yeah. Extraordinary acts are followed by less extraordinary acts. If your parents are both tall, the likelihood is you're going to be shorter than them, not taller than them. You know, there would be a race of huge people and little people. You know, everything in the universe pulls down to some norm. And so when you see these extraordinary events or extraordinary people, you know, artists, just everybody kind of joins in bringing them down. It's amazing how uncharitable. Like, I'm not above it. At the time, I was like disappointed that he was farting around with teenage subject matter when he should have been. I mean, how do you go from Apocalypse Now? So I was, you know, I liked it, but I didn't love it the way I loved the other films. So at that time. I appreciate so much more, you know, yeah, what yeah. The kind of the boldness and the way he was going about his business. You know, it's pretty crazy and wonderful.
And you kind of began to appreciate
it. He's not playing
it
safe. He's not a guy who's trying to be a good boy.
Yeah, this is not
pay off his
safe.
Debts and be a good boy for the studio. That's kind of like going, fuck you. Yeah, I'll make a studio film about teenagers, but I'm going to do it this way. You know, and
This is really one of the great summer movies too, about the just sort of like when you're a kid and it's summertime and it's like this other dimension. Yeah,
okay. And it's also one of the great, I mean, Matt Dillon's that thing about being a teenager and just like you just don't understand, like, what does that have to do with that? What are you talking about? You know, like, it's just all testosterone, but he can't figure it out. Everyone's in his face, and yet he can't figure what the fuck is going on? It's like he's in the middle of all these mythic things around him, but he doesn't understand the myth. Motorcycle Boy's his own brother, his dad, you know, speaking these, it's like a coded language.
People talking about the Greeks and all this stuff. What
yeah,
is
even
this?
Tom
right.
Waits is the bartender's whispering, you know, that's just so amazing. You know you're off to the races at the beginning when Tom Waits is, you know, it's like, oh God, I kind of love this, you know, it's like crazy.
It looks like this movie, just from watching it and listening in on it, it looks like it was totally post-synced. It looks like it's filmed without location sound, mostly.
Yeah, is that it almost might. Because, I mean, the ultimate sound design is so impressionistic. You know, it's so otherworldly. But I heard, yeah, maybe that's the case. I don't know factually, but, you know, a lot of the, you know, Italian and French films of the 50s, 60s, they were all post song.
And then you had big loud Mitchell cameras and they needed to.
It's like, what the hell? We're going to be post-syncing it all anyway. And he had all these plans for these, you know, where you hear a line from earlier in the movie or, you know, one of my favorite lines is like, it's in black and white and turned down real low. You know, how Mickey Rourke's character, you know, how the motorcycle boy sees the world and the sounds. And I heard at the time, though, there was some publicity around, you know, Stuart Copeland was on the set playing music live and stuff, off camera, obviously, but, you know, he was setting this musical kind of odd tone. It's a really fantastic score. I mean, it's amazing.
Yeah, I hate the Police.
Yeah.
And I love
this is
the
like
score.
Post-Police. Yeah. I mean, yeah. I don't know if Police were on hiatus or Stuart. I don't know where they were at that time, but it's very effective. It's really kind of captures this. It adds, you know, what year? I mean, this is obviously contemporary cars and stuff, but it also seems like it's from some other era also. I don't think people exactly look like that or dress, you know, it's just weird, you know, what?
Yeah, it's sort of odd to see like a 1980 car driving by.
Yeah, it could be 50s, but it couldn't be. I think it was written, Essie Hinton wrote these at least a decade before. Who knows more about that? I mean, she wrote these as a teenager girl, and she used the name kind of J.K. Rowling-esque. She used her name because mm-hmm. she, you know, these kind of male stories, they didn't think a young woman would. She was like a teenager.
And how about black and white? Oh yeah. My God.
What works so well. I think so. Were they going so far as to like paint shadows? I think I heard that at the time, you know, that kind of going so far as to really play up those shadows and light.
Yeah, there's some parts where there's like where the girls are walking down the street and their dresses are so black that it's like bleeding. Like Nicolas Cage's hair is like bleeding into the rest of the frame. It's so cool.
Yeah, Orson Welles said, you can't. There's never been a great performance in color. You know, Peter Bogdanovich told me that. And I said, really? You're talking about a lot of cinema history. No, name one. You know. So not that that means anything ultimately, but it does beg the question. Yeah, black and white. Dennis Hopper is just so sitting when he's in close-up at that time.
Yeah.
And the fight scene at the beginning of the film is so well choreographed. I mean, the way the water, the backlit water, and the swing in the shadows. Yeah, that just it's a whole different movie. It could only exist in black and white. I mean, there's not a color version of this movie. Forget it.
Do it.
You know, it just wouldn't exist.
Yeah, it'd
be terrible.
It's a pretty special film. Buddy Joe Hooker did the stunts.
Yeah, I mean, that's such a well... And Matt really sells it, you know? I mean, he can throw a punch. You know, he's not... A lot of actors, you know, when it comes time to deliver, but he's really like, wham! You know, so...
Yeah, it's intense. The performances are amazing.
I love that fight scene.
Like pretty much every shot, it's like you look at every single shot, like even just like a little shot, it's like, wow, they must have been so happy to get that shot. They must have been every single shot.
I know, and such strange little, you know, odd shots. You know, in the middle of that fight, there's that strange point of view where you're the knife and the thing's caught on you. Like, what an odd idea just to throw that in there. And just, there's so many of those.
It's funny because it was a time where everybody was talking about MTV style filmmaking and those other stylization that. Most of it, you look back at it, it looks like all the Michael Mann type stuff looks really sort of empty and
what it really
phony.
Means that MTV, as far as I could tell, just meant a lot of cuts.
Yeah, exactly.
It means you don't have a visual style. You've got nothing to say. So and this fit the 80s overall. It just set a visual palette for the rest of the forever, I guess. But just keep cutting.
Yeah, keep the eye interested.
Yeah, yeah, we get bored. I can't look at anything more than 12 seconds.
Right.
So just keep it going, and I'm going to be, you know, razzle-dazzle. I'm just going to be, you know.
In a weird sort of way, that this movie is sort of like a response to that.
Yeah.
It's like, I can do that too, only, fuck, like every scene, every shot is interesting.
Yeah,
you know?
So admirable. And, Nicolas Cage. I think this was the first movie he went by Cage, is it? You know, he's Cage in the credits.
Brother Nicolas Cage.
And this was the same year. I had seen Baby, It's You. I don't know if you know that film, the John Sayles film. And Vincent, is it Spano or Spano? Spano. Anyway, he's so great in that movie. And he plays such a, you know, Steve is such a nerd, such a prude, you know, future writer. Maybe he's writing the film. But he was kind of the Matt Dillon of that film. And to see him playing such a straight-laced guy with glasses was so shocking. I was off-put by it at the time. I like his performance now, but at the time I was like, that's not him. He's the guy from that movie. He had missed out on The Outsiders, too, to do Baby, It's You with John Sayles.
For you total completists of this series who want to, after it's over in a few weeks, unfortunately, alas, after it's over in a few weeks, want to keep it going, Baby, It's You is one of the ones we couldn't get a print
of. Yeah, no, there'll be a little list at the end of keep it going over the summer.
Yeah. There's no print of that, but we tried. But
Baby
It's You is one that you
should
watch.
I mean, there's so many films. This is just a taste, but that's one of them.
I wonder if we have any contributions, questions, et cetera, from the audience. Anybody. What a movie, huh? Yeah, right over here.
Yeah. I'm coming to this film completely new. I hadn't heard about it or seen anything or known anything about it, but... What year did you say it came out in?
83.
83, okay. I felt like I was watching Born to Run, like the entire album of Bruce Springsteen. And I don't know, was it... You said the novel was written like 10 years before the movie came out.
Who knows?
I think it was around 79 or something.
Early
60s?
Late 60s, early...
76.
76.
Yeah.
76. Yeah, I missed out on it. I mean, I was just old enough to know that, like, I was beyond young adult, so I never read those. I was like, you know, I felt they were beneath me.
The novels are great, though, because they're like neo-realists. Like, they're totally the opposite of this kind of hardcore neo-realist, but with this continuing, like, really sensitive male. It's almost like the same protagonist in all of them.
Yeah.
He's this deeply sensitive adolescent male, and I don't know if there's ever been anything where you have this, like, male vulnerability front and center.
Mm-hmm.
It's amazing. And then in this like totally stripped down neo-realist kind of language, it's amazing. Actually, I highly recommend it.
And they adapted these together. You know, she's co-writer, so they were, you know, you see her cameo in here. She's the, hitting them up.
by the stairwell when you see her when she's got the sort of curly hair.
And Sophia Coppola.
Yeah.
Coppola, excuse me. I'll never remember. She's the little punk little sister. Yeah. I think it was just a family. Both his sons, who weren't very old, either one of them, I think they're teenagers or associate producers.
Yeah.
So this is a family, maybe just started handing out credits to the family pretty early. But now I'm sure they all worked on it. I mean, they were like family undertakings, these couple adventures, famously, you know, bring them all along, like put them to work.
Yeah. Has Tom Waits ever done a bad performance in a film? Like, he's brilliant.
This was his first.
Yeah, this is like, oh, Tom Waits is showing up in the movie.
Down by law.
Yeah, no, I think he got the bug here, too. He's working with great people. And, yeah, then he... What's Tom Waits' greatest film? I mean, I like Down by Law. Sometimes.
Down by Law has to be so good.
Guy is so good.
It's because it's the biggest role that he played.
Yeah.
You see, it
played the Field of the Lords, remember that one? The Hector Babenka film? It's a pretty big part in that. But still, you know, Down by Law.
Pretty good Renfield.
Yeah. Okay. A lot of love going out to Tom Waits tonight.
Well, he's great.
He's great. He really.
He seems so authentic and inauthentic at the same time in this weird sort of way.
I know. So, yeah, like every character is in their own damn myth. I mean, Mickey Rourke, for those who come in late to the Mickey Rourke, this is why Mickey Rourke is Mickey Rourke. You know, this and he, right at this stage, he was between Diner and Pope Gunnar's Trilogy was coming up after this, another year or so, but you know, he and Eric Roberts were, I mean, this is the same year as Star 80, so you get Paul Schneider together with that guy, you know.
Watch out.
Let's make a movie. You know, and Dennis Hopper in this movie, he's interestingly positioned, obviously. You know, he's one of Francis's guys, you know, Apocalypse Now and everything, but he was, as is Lawrence Fishburne, you know, he was from The Boat in Apocalypse Now, so you know, Hopper wasn't sober yet. You know, if you know that, he's kind of, I think Coppola always had a way to sort of integrate him. I mean, there's some just incredible moments. You know, I don't know, I have no idea what his condition was like on the thing, but he was famously, you know, way out there in this period. And we will see a film in 2 weeks that he actually directed while he was in that kind of mode.
And we'll also hear a pretty incredible story from you, I hope.
Oh yeah, I was at the premiere. Yeah.
But we'll talk more about Dennis Hopper later. But Dennis Hopper also had a really interesting position in
little sort of gestures and
the cinema of youth rebellion too.
Yeah,
having been a rebel without a cause and then landing in Easy Rider.
So I know.
Nobody was more perfectly positioned.
Yeah, at every phase of his own life. And now it was weird for me. This is the first time I'd ever seen him play a dad. Yeah, he's a great drunken crazy fuck dad, but he was. I was like, wow, Dennis Hopper's a dad now. Just kidding.
Transitions. I saw a hand all the way in the back.
Yeah.
I was curious, one of the things you were talking about, how there's so many quick cuts in this, MTV, but one of the things I really was blown away by is some of the long tracking shots.
I was saying there wasn't a lot of cuts. Yeah, that's what MTV is, a lot of cuts. This isn't that, admirably so.
But some of the walking, talking shots of the tracking, and I was curious because it made me think a little bit of Slacker in some ways, and I was just kind of curious of your thoughts on when is a good time to do those kind of shots, and what do you have to think about when you're doing it?
You know, just whenever it's the way to tell the story, you know? I mean, I like the tracking shots in this, you know, the one that goes up over them when they're walking down the street. The one at the end is wonderful, you know, that kind of sums up the entire movie very economically. We see every character in that shot. So, I don't know, you know, just always a choice.
A lot of it's clever if you know Tulsa. There's only a very small area that has that old town look to it.
Yeah, some of the like shots, they're in a little.
Yeah, some of those locations square blocks across the street is a giant, you know, glass tower. Mm-hmm. Like it was in freeways. They're shooting underneath the freeway a lot, and you never see the freeway. It's what's left of the old part of Tulsa.
Yeah,
and so that like the crane shots where they're looking down on the street, well, they can't see the buildings on either side.
Because it's hiding everything.
Yeah, the clock. You see is the clock. Like they pulled that whole scene moves straight towards the big clock face and straight out because you never see what's on the side of the streets. Yeah, it's steam tunnels.
You know, it didn't fit the visual palette.
Yeah.
The design of the movie was this kind of. But you know, I think those guys walk through a modern setting and they only see the old stuff, the, you know, that story he's living under, you know, his kind of other ideas.
In a weird way, it seems like Rusty James is kind of like a rat in a maze, kind of,
yeah.
And that's, it's maybe sort of appropriate that the sort of language of the way the story is told is they're just in a maze and they can't see over the wall. I wonder if we have, right back here.
In regards to what Rick said earlier about Stuart Copeland on the set, he was better known later for like in 85 is when he went to Africa and would record the actual tribes doing music and play with them for the rhythmist. But when they did this film, what happened was he actually walked around Tulsa, recorded sound, and then incorporated using something called MuSync, which was new and innovative at the time, and actually went on to get an Academy Award later that the actual inventor did for that.
Oh, cool.
So he had a lot of different side projects. You know, Clark Kent was his alter ego before that. His brother, Miles Copeland, was actually the founder of IRS Records,
right,
which is
yeah.
why he had the access to Stan Ridgway.
Mm-hmm.
So
what was MuSync? Like some sort of MIDI triggering kind of thing or something?
It was a way to actually take tempo and to change it, and it was
some
sort of like
digital
like post-production sort of thing.
Yeah.
Take this.
That's early auto-tune.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Cool.
Yeah. What if we have maybe one or two other contributions from the audience over here? Right over here, yeah.
I just wanted to comment on the sound design. Like, I was overwhelmed. I thought
yeah,
almost as
huge.
Much
audit, sound audit, design.
Yeah, just there was so much going on, and I rarely hear that.
Yeah, it's so impressive.
It never stopped, ever. Is there any silence in the film?
I don't think so. Between the score,
it's almost like an Altman movie or
the
something.
The voices
like
coming in, the score,
the
just the sound.
The clock ticking in the whole first, I don't know,
clocks, 5 minutes. Clocks.
Mm-hmm.
And then there's the handless clock. They go just walk up and stage it kind of proscenium style. It's like, wow, okay, that's so obvious and so kind of ballsy at the same time. It's like, wow, okay.
It's cool seeing the great old biker movie actor William Smith playing the cop, too.
Yeah, what a.
he's like a terrifying cop. He's like like a nightmare cop.
I know that you could actually kill a guy for dumping some fish in. You know, and no one's gonna say, you know, hey, get this guy. He's just like all in a day's work. Happy to invite him. Like what?
That's Tulsa.
And I guess shoot him in the back, no less. You know, or whatever.
Stuff like that happens in Tulsa. Doesn't even make the news. Right over here.
Does anybody know who played Billy, the guy in the fight? I don't know if he was credited, you know, just in the you know, random guy.
The guy with that face that you just hate automatically.
Yeah, a couple lines in a great fight scene, but there's no credit for him anymore.
Oh yeah, what's his name?
He looks somewhat familiar, but
yeah, he is. There.
Oh, if only we all carried little computers around with us.
If we could just IMDb that really quick and know by the end of the sentence.
But he's not on IMDb or anything.
Chris Penn. He's in the credits. His name.
Oh, you mean Chris Penn is in there? Yeah.
Well, Chris Penn, but no, the guy you're talking about.
Yeah,
with
the sort of spiky blonde hair.
We'll figure this out.
Bad guy. Yeah,
I'll figure it out. Amazing experience watching this movie.
Yeah, it's cool. I mean, the movie, it has its place, you know. I know it's not everyone's cup of tea, but it's such an odd moment in time, you know, that it exists and he made it at this point. And, I don't know. It says something.
Do you ever think about,
a gutsy choice as in the year of Flashdance and everything else.
To make a black and white movie, period, would be a gutsy choice, but all of this other stuff, too.
It's probably not fair to him. A few years earlier, you know, there's Raging Bull, and he gets all in.
Yeah,
Francis makes his, and everybody just kind of craps on it. But it's like, well, you already got your accolades.
Have you made? You haven't made a black and white movie, have you?
Mm-mm.
Have you ever thought about
it? No. Yeah, sure. I have a couple. You know, again, it's such a choice. You know, it's got to be the right look for the right story. I kind of resent it when people just do it just to be, for some reason other than, you know, just kind of feel like they're just farting around.
If you're making a period story, it probably goes a long way towards giving it sort of an authentic look because period stories are often derailed by their color, in a way.
Well, the way we think about periods, but, you know, it adds that automatic, nostalgic thing to it, but it's kind of easy. You know, if you really look back in history, very colorful time. Mm-hmm. We just see it in black and white because the photos are black and white.
Sure, sure.
The memory is black and white, I think. Mm-hmm. But, you know, you get into the actual facts of it. Pretty colorful eras, you know, in the 20th century, you know, the 20s or something. So, but it's just, it's forever black and white, I guess. But, you know, it works in movies. And the Last Picture Show, that was a bold choice in 71 because I think they had almost, studios had almost mandated, I think from like, there was some moment in the 60s, okay, the studio head comes in. Okay, all films are in color. You know, just we're not messing around with black and white ever again. And filmmakers just really had to fight past a certain point sometime in the 60s. And you just don't see that many black and white films. You know, so every time someone was going to the mat just to get their black and white film made.
Yeah, it was, that came from exhibitors. Exhibitors are like, we only want color. And when Last Picture Show came out, it was still kind of a thing like, what is this? Like, yeah. It wasn't seen as a stylistic choice. It was just
well,
like, why
you have an audience money? Going, because I think it was kind of like when you had money, you could get a color TV. Like, I grew up in, I didn't know The Wizard of Oz had a color section, you know, growing up. Everything was in black and white, but it meant you had money or something to have color. So I remember hearing this line I'm about to say. Why would we go to a black and white movie when we can go to a color movie? You know, like, why would you pay money for that when you...
Yeah.
You know, so it meant, like, low rent or should be on TV or free or, you know, it just didn't represent progress.
Yeah.
Which, you know, it's like, why would you have a wood floor when we can have beautiful shag carpeting on top of it? You know, it's that era, you know. Like, that old thing, let's get rid of it, you know.
Well, next week, the movie's in color. So
yes, yes. So come back next week. We'll do better. We'll show a color movie. Sorry,
But it's also a movie that has a lot about you know the past and people living by codes, et cetera.
Yeah.
It's Atlantic City,
legitimately so. Yeah, beautiful film. Louis Malle, Burt Lancaster's fantastic,
and
Susan Sarandon in her. Susan Sarandon prime. That's a long prime.
Yeah,
I don't know where, but this is prime.
Yeah,
Susan Sarandon. So, yeah, it's wonderful, and I think it's one of those that hasn't been. You know, it's like a lot of the films in this. It's that was such a great film. It got acclaim, notoriety, and played for a few years. You know, in repertory houses, and then I just realized it seems like people don't talk about it.
Mm-hmm.
Louis Malle went on to do a lot more films and. Burt Lancaster also, but even as an old man in that part of his career. But for some reason, I don't hear people talking about that one in the same level I view it. So I'm curious to see it again and see how it holds up. But at the time, it was, you know,
it's one of those weird movies.
Wonderful.
It had like 8 Academy Award nominations.
Yeah, it's kind of like Melvin and Howard.
Yeah.
I think it did. I don't know if it did any better than Melvin and Howard. But back then, a film that everyone said, God, what a great film. But I don't think it was huge box office or anything. But it was... You know, solid effort, and
it's great.
It'll be great to see it. Yeah,
it's the kind of movie that ought to be really sort of depressing, but it's not.
It's not.
It's hopeful.
Yeah. Yeah, it's really cool, and it's not like overly commercial, but it's not overly arty either. It's got drug deals and shootings, so it's like Louis Malle art film guy or trying to be American filmmaker guy. He's right in between, and it has all of it. It's kind of everything. So that's what I remember of it, but I haven't seen it in so long. So, but I so look forward to seeing it, and you know, come check it out, man.
So we'll have that next week.
Burt Lancaster.
Although the studio actually, this is a true story. The studio contacted me 2 days ago and said, "By the way, we lost the print. We're looking everywhere for it. We hope." And so I booked a backup. So hopefully we'll have the studio print. But if we don't, we'll have like a print that might have some lines and some scratches in it. But that's life in the big city, you guys. That's just the way it works.
Yeah. It'll be great no matter what. So anyway, well, thanks for being here. We'll see you next week. Thank you.
All right.